Hello everyone. So today we'll have our part 2 of chapter 12, electricity. Here we'll be discussing sections 12.4 to 12.5 from your NCERT book. The main contents of this presentation are Ohm's law. Under Ohm's law, circuit diagram to verify Ohm's law, VI characteristics of Ohm's law. Then we'll discuss about an important term, resistance, factors on which resistance of a conductor depends. Under this, we will discuss another term, resistivity. So these are the main contents of this presentation. Let us start with Ohm's law. In 1827, a German physicist, George Simon Ohm, found out the relationship between the current flowing in a metallic wire and the potential difference across its terminals. So in Ohm's law, we are getting a relation between current flowing in a metallic wire, current flowing in a metallic wire, and the potential difference across its terminals. So these two terms we have already studied in your previous presentation. Current I and potential difference denoted by V. So we are going to get a relation, important relationship between current and potential difference in any circuit or in any metallic wire. This is the Ohm's law statement. So by Ohm's law, electric current I flowing through a metallic wire is directly proportional to potential difference V across the two points of a metallic conductor, provided that temperature remains constant. So by Ohm's law, electric current I flowing through a metallic wire is directly proportional to potential difference V across the two points of a metallic conductor. The condition for this statement is temperature should remain constant. If temperature is varying, then there is a change in this relationship. Okay, so here voltage and current, or potential difference and current, are directly proportional. Now we'll see the mathematical expression for Ohm's law. V is proportional to I. This is the proportionality sign. Okay, you might have seen this in previous classes also. This is proportional in mathematics and any other subject. V is proportional to I. Removing the proportionality constant and we are using the equality sign, we have to include a constant term. That constant is denoted by R. Okay. So the formula becomes V is equal to I into R. R is the proportionality constant known as resistance. Okay, resistance. So this is the formula for Ohm's law. V is equal to I into R. What is V here? Potential difference. I, current. R, resistance. So R is a constant called resistance for the given metal or material, whatever it is. The resistance. Okay, we will be explaining what is resistance. So remember, this is our Ohm's law. V is equal to I into R. Very, very important relationship. Okay. Now we'll see which is the electric circuit for studying Ohm's law. So studying Ohm's law means we have to get this relation. V is proportional to I. Okay? And for that, we have to consider a circuit here. So this is the circuit we are considering to study Ohm's law. Okay, what are the components of the circuit? You can see a resistance wire XY, okay, of resistance R. So a wire, okay, this is a wire with resistance R. This is the notation for resistance. Then ammeter is connected, voltmeter is connected, then cells are connected. Here you can see four cells. But only one at a time will be connecting. This dotted line represents one at a time will be connecting to the circuit. First we will connect only one cell, then remove this connection and we will connect here, that is two cells at a time, then three cells at a time, then four cells at a time. Like that we do connection. in the circuit. Ammeter is here, voltmeter is here, then key, this is the key, okay, notation of key. And resistance is actually the property of any material, any conducting wire, there is a property called resistance. How much current it allows to pass, accordingly we have defined a term resistance. That will be explained in the next slide. Okay, so this is the notation for resistance. So in the figure you can see a metallic wire XY. So this wire is made up of a material called nichrome. Okay, nichrome is an alloy of nickel, chromium, manganese and iron. Okay, so nichrome wire is used here. Then ammeter, voltmeter, key and four cells. These are the main components of the circuit. Okay, and this is actually the activity 12.1 of your course book. Okay, activity 12.1. So these activities you need to study. First of all, what you have to do is connect only one cell in a circuit. One cell, okay, one cell you have to connect. Then current starts flowing in the circuit. See, one cell you are connected at a circuit, okay. Here we have given the connection. So what happens? Current starts flowing in the circuit. Current starts flowing in the circuit with this one connection. Then you have to note down what is the current flowing using ammeter. So ammeter will show the reading, okay. In the ammeter, you can see how much current flows the circuit. So ammeter reading you need to note down. And voltmeter for the potential difference. And voltmeter reading also you have to note down. And here you can observe that ammeter is connected in series with the circuit and voltmeter is connected in parallel with the circuit. This is known as parallel connection. Where you want to find out the potential difference, which point you want to find out the potential difference. Across that you need to connect the voltmeter. So in this particular circuit, we have to find out the potential difference across this resistance nichrome wire XY. Nichrome wire XY. So one end of the voltmeter is connected to one end of the nichrome wire. Other end is connected to other end of the nichrome wire. An ammeter should be connected in series with the circuit where the current is flowing. That is when you connect this cell in the circuit, the current starts flowing from positive to negative. Positive to negative. Accordingly, the direction is shown. This arrow mark shows the direction. Okay, positive to negative the current flows. Since positive to negative the current flows, this positive is put here, negative is put here with ammeter as well as in the voltmeter. So all these things you need to know. Okay, so when a cell is connected positive and negative, this is the positive of the cell, negative of the cell, then current flow direction is from positive to negative. Okay, that you have studied in the previous class. Current direction is positive to negative. So first of all, with one cell, we have measured ammeter reading and voltmeter reading. Next, connect two cells in the circuit and note down the ammeter and voltmeter readings. So this step you have to repeat for all the three and four cells in the circuit. Okay, all the four cells, one by one you will connect. And finally, you will connect all the four cells in the circuit and take the ammeter and voltmeter reading. Now calculate, then finally, so voltmeter and ammeter reading you have measured and find out the ratio of V and I for each pair of V and I. So this is the tabular column for this experiment. Okay, number of cell, first one cell you will connect, note down ammeter reading, that is current, note down voltmeter reading, that is V, note down V by I or calculate V by I, you will get one value here. Similarly, connecting two cells in the circuit, find I, V and V by I. Then connect three cells in the circuit, find I, V and V by I. Four cells in the circuit, I, V and V by I. You can notice that this V by I, that is last column of this tabular column, will be always remain same. It will be constant. Slight difference may be there, but it remains constant. Same value you will get. That is the meaning of V is proportional to I. That is how much V is I is varying or V is varying, accordingly I also varies. Or vice versa. How much current flow changes, accordingly potential also changes proportionally. So this ratio always remains constant. That is the basic concept of Ohm's law. So this is the observation. It is found that V by I value for each pair remains constant. It means that V is directly proportional to I. Okay, which is the Ohm's law statement. And this ratio of V and I is known as resistance of the circuit. So this ratio is called resistance of the circuit. Okay, now VI graph for Ohm's law. Now let us understand what is the VI characteristics or VI graph for Ohm's law. So the variation of potential or V with respect to current, that variation, that is V versus I graph, is called VI graph or VI characteristic. And the nature of the graph is like this. It is a straight line with a slope. V is proportional to I. So how much current is increasing, accordingly voltage also increases in proportional rate. So this is the nature of the graph. And we can draw this graph I here and V here also, IV graph also. Because with respect to V, I changes. With respect to V, I changes. Similarly, with respect to I, V changes. Both way you can draw the graph. But nature of the graph is always remains like this. A straight line with a slope. So the plot shows the variation of V with I, which is called VI characteristics. It is a straight line with a slope. This shows that V varies linearly with I. Now the slope of the graph is given by the Y term divided by X term, that is slope, that we have studied in your previous class also. In motion, different graphs when we have discussed, slope of the graph is given by Y coordinate by X coordinate. So according to this graph, when we are plotting V in the Y axis and I in the X axis, the slope is given by V by I, and this ratio is nothing but our resistance. Because by Ohm's law, V is equal to I into R, that is V by I is equal to R. Now we will discuss about resistance. What is a resistance? So this is a simple for resistance. Okay, now we will define what is resistance. It is a property of a conductor. Okay, it is a property of a conductor to oppose the flow of charge through it. To oppose the charge through it. So this is repeated. Property of a conductor is the twice it is written here. Okay, only once you need to write. Okay, it is the property of a conductor to oppose the flow of charge through it. Okay, how much current flows in a conductor, that depends upon the nature of the conductor. For a different conductor, the current flow will be different. It is not the same for all conductors or through all devices or through all components. It will be different for different devices. Accordingly, we define a term known as resistance. Okay, and resistance is given by Ohm's law. R is equal to V by I. Okay, it's simple, is like this. This is the notation for resistance. This resistance can also be defined as the, based on Ohm's law, we can define resistance also as the ratio of potential difference to the current. R is equal to V by I through a conductor. SI unit of resistance is ohm. This is the name of a scientist. So based on his, from his name, the unit is given. So it is ohm, O-H-M. This is a Greek letter. Ohm is used to represent the resistance. And from this formula, resistance unit is ohm. 1 ohm is equal to the unit of V is volt and unit of I is ampere. So we can write 1 ohm is equal to 1 volt by 1 ampere. Okay. Now from this formula, R is equal to V by I, you can also write that the current through the resistor is inversely proportional to its resistance. That is, if the resistance doubled, current halved, inversely proportional. It means R in the R is here and I in the denominator. So the relation is between R and I is inverse. When R increases, current decreases. When resistance decreases, current increases. So resistance is actually the property of a conductor. More resistance a conductor offers means less current flow through the resistance. Sorry, through the wire. Okay. So I is equal to V by R. So we can write when current decreases, resistance and current inversely related. Resistance increases, current decreases. Okay. Now calculation of the resistance from the graph between V and I. Here two graphs are shown, both are VI characteristics, but drawn. First graph V here and I here. V along the Y axis, I along the X axis. In the second graph, I is drawn along the Y axis and V along the X axis. I have already mentioned we can draw in both the ways. VI characteristics can be drawn either like this or like this. But But nature of the graph is 7 and only same in both the graph. The graph OA is the straight line with a slope. Here also a straight line with a slope. So in order to calculate the resistance from the graph, what you have to find out? Slope you have to find out, right? We'll see how it differs in both the graphs. If you draw V here and I, VI graph like this, how will we find out the resistance? Similarly, if you draw IV graph, how will we find out the resistance? So first of all, let us consider the figure 1, graph 1. Here slope is given divided by slope of this line OA. Slope of the curve OA is given by Y coordinate, that is AC. This is Y coordinate divided by X coordinate OC. Okay. So Y by X, that is nothing but V divided by I or R. So according to first graph, the resistance R is equal to slope of the VI graph. So in this graph directly we get resistance is equal to slope. Now consider the figure 2 for the I versus V graph. Here I is on the Y axis, V on the X axis. This is called IV characteristics. Okay, IV characteristics. Here we can find out the slope is equal to same way Y coordinate by X coordinate, that is AC by OC. But here Y coordinate is I, right? I, not V. So Y is I and X is V. So the different relation we are getting, I by V we are getting. So from the Ohm's law statement, V by I is equal to R. Therefore I by V is equal to 1 by R. Okay, 1 by R. That means the resistance R is given by 1 divided by slope of IV graph. So these two differences you need to understand properly. Slope from the, that is from VI graph, to calculate resistance you have to calculate the slope directly, that is V by I. Whereas in the IV graph, in order to calculate the slope you have to consider the reciprocal of the slope, that is 1 divided by slope. Because directly if you calculate slope, what will you get? I by V. But our resistance is V by I. So 1 by slope will give you resistance in the second graph. Okay, this is the difference when the graph is drawn in two different ways. In both the way you can draw. Now another term associated with resistance is rheostat. This simple also we have studied, rheostat. It is a component used in electronics, in any electric circuit, a component or device used to change the resistance. It is also known as variable resistance. Okay, rheostat or variable resistance is a component used to regulate current without changing the source of voltage. Its symbol is like this. Okay, that means you will understand when we do the practical based on this. It is a device used in the laboratories, in this which is connected in the circuit to change the flow of current in the circuit without changing the source of voltage, means without changing the cell. We can connect only one cell at a time, and to vary the current we can use this device. Instead of increasing the number of cells, we can connect this device. Now to demonstrate electric resistance of different components, that is based in Ohm's law what we have studied, different components will provide different resistance. Okay, different components or different materials have different resistance. In order to demonstrate that, there is an activity which is activity 12.2 of your book. So in this activity again we are considering an electric circuit with ammeter, cells, how many cells, 1, 2, 3, 4 cells connected together, a key, and a gap is provided. XY is the gap provided to connect three components. We have considered three electric components here. First component is a nichrome wire, a simple nichrome wire. Second component is a torch bulb, small bulb. Third component is another bulb of high rating, 10 watt bulb. Okay, it's watt is the power. Okay, power of this bulb is more compared to this torch bulb. This is a very small bulb we are using, which you can see in the torch, a small bulb, you can see that one. This is another one with a high rating, high power, and one nichrome wire. These are the three components we are considering in this circuit, and we are checking how much current flows in the circuit when we connect these devices, these components, one at a time. First we will connect this nichrome wire, then we will connect the torch bulb, then we will connect this 10 watt bulb in the circuit, and we will check out for how much current flows in the circuit using this ammeter. Then we can obtain a relationship that it will, the different components will offer different resistance to the circuit. So let us consider these three components: a nichrome wire, a toast bulb, ammeter, cell and key. And this component also is there, okay, another bulb of 10 watt. Set up the circuit as shown. First of all, you have to consider the nichrome wire in the gap XY. Note down the current flowing through the circuit using ammeter, okay. Ammeter will show the reading. That's it. When you connect the nichrome wire here, the circuit is complete. It will become a closed circuit. Key is on. So current starts flowing in the circuit from positive to negative. This is the direction of the current. So you can note down the current flow in the ammeter. Second step, replace the nichrome wire with a torch bulb. Secondly, you have to connect a torch bulb here. Remove the nichrome wire, connect the torch bulb here. In this gap, you connect a torch bulb. Note down the current flowing through the circuit using ammeter. In the third step, you have to connect this bulb, 10 watt bulb, in the gap XY and note down the ammeter reading. There is different components. You are connecting one at a time and checking for the current, how much current flows in the circuit. And it is observed that different components, we are getting different reading. For the nichrome wire, one ammeter reading will get. When you are connecting torch bulb, different current. When we are connecting 10 watt bulb, the current rating, current flowing through the ammeter is different. It's all the three components, different amount of current flows in the circuit. What does it mean? These three different components will offer different resistance in the circuit. That is, these components allows a particular amount of current only, and this component allows particular amount of current only. Like that, different amount of current flows in the circuit. That is due to the factor that the resistance offered by different component in the circuit is different. So more resistance if it offers, the current flow will be less. More resistance, less current, or less resistance, more current. That is the Ohm's law. So observation is, ammeter reading is different for different components. This is because different components offer different resistance to the flow of conductor. If resistance increases, current decreases, and vice versa. So based on this observation, there is a relation V is equal to I into R, or R is equal to V by I. That means different components will have different property. That property is called resistance of that particular material or particular component. That is the conclusion of this observation. Resistance is the property of material which resists the flow of electric current. Okay? From this we can observe that resistance of these different components is different. Now we'll move on to the next topic, that is factors on which resistance of a conductor depends. What are the different factors the resistance of a conductor depends? So the different factors are length of the conductor, area of cross section, temperature, and nature of the material. So resistance of a metallic conductor, that means we have seen what is resistance. It is a property that different component, different materials offer for the current flow. So resistance of a conductor depends on, directly it is, the relation is like this: resistance of a conductor is directly proportional to length of conductor, inversely proportional to the area of cross section, directly proportional to temperature, that is temperature increases, resistance also increases. Depends on nature of the material. For different materials, the resistance will be different. So directly proportional means as the length of the conductor increases, resistance increases. Inversely proportional means when area increases, resistance decreases. Temperature increases, resistance increases. Then for different material, resistance is different. So these are the different factors. There is an activity to demonstrate the factors on which resistance of a conductor depends. Okay, this is that activity. I think it is 12.3. I think this not make it confirmed 12.2 or 12.3. So to demonstrate the factors on which resistance of a conductor depends, this is that activity from your book. So this is the circuit diagram for that. Here also it consists of a key, ammeter, a cell. One cell is connected, and here a wire is connected, okay, wire 1 is connected, and some other wires are also shown here, 2 3, 4, like that. So what is the difference? This is the wire 1, a nichrome wire 1. Here also nichrome wire is used. Nichrome wire 1 of particular length is used here. Length L is used here. And second one you can see here, that is the length of this wire is double of the length of the first wire. So second wire is length more. Now third wire is same length of one but area more. More thicker wire is used. That means area of cross section of this wire is more. Fourth wire is another wire of different material. Okay, like that four different components we are using in this to check what are the factors on which resistance of the conductor depends and how it varies with the different factors. Set up the circuit as shown. It consists of a nichrome wire, cell, ammeter and key. First of all, wire 1 of length L and area A is connected and ammeter reading is noted down. That is first wire is this one. Wire 1 is connected in the circuit and note down the ammeter reading in the circuit. Okay, that means when wire 1 is connected, cell is connected, current starts flowing. So what is the direction? Positive to negative. So like this, positive to negative, anti-clockwise direction. Like this, current starts flowing in the circuit. Accordingly, you have to put the positive and negative to the ammeter according to the direction of current, positive to negative. So like this, current flowing in the circuit, note down the ammeter reading in the circuit with the wire 1. Step 2, replace wire 1 with wire 2. What is the difference in wire 2? Its length is twice the length of the first wire. So wire 2 of length 2L is connected. Step 3, replace wire 2 with wire 3. What is the difference in wire 3? It is thicker wire. Thicker wire, you can see it is thicker. Thicker means area is more. Area is more. In wire 3, area is more. So we have to note down how the current varies in with a different wires. That means if length increases, how much difference is there? If area increases, what is the difference? For that purpose, we are using this activity. Step 4, replace wire 3 with wire 4, which is a copper wire. So first one, we have started with a nichrome wire and now we are replacing it with a copper wire. Okay, first one was nichrome wire. That means we are changing the material. Nichrome and copper, different materials. So what is the changes in the current? We are noting down. So like that, we are doing this activity. Wire 1, wire 2 and wire 3 and wire 4, one at a time, we are connecting and noting the ammeter reading. What are the observations? First observation, when with wire 1, we observe the ammeter reading. And it is observed that when we are replacing the wire 1 with the wire 2, that is when the length of the wire is doubled, the ammeter reading decreases. That means current flowing through it decreases. What does it mean? When length of the wire is doubled or length of the wire is increases, the current decreases. Current decreases means what would be the changes in the resistance? When the current decreases, when resistance increases. So we can conclude that when length of the wire is increases, resistance increases. Therefore, the current decreases. That is the first relation. Resistance of the wire is directly proportional to length. Length increases, resistance increases, so current decreases. That is why ammeter reading decreases in the with the wire of length 2L. Another observation is when the ammeter reading is increases as area of cross section of the wire increases. That is when we are using the thicker wire, area of cross section is more, the ammeter reading increases, current increases. What does it mean? Current increases means resistance decreases. So with the thicker wire, resistance decreases and current increases because resistance and current are opposite. Resistance increases, current decreases. So with the thicker wire, ammeter reading increases. It means resistance of the wire decreases. Okay. So that is another relation. So resistance is inversely related to area of cross section. More area, less resistance. So current increases. Third observation is ammeter reading changes. How much change we don't know. That depends upon the material. So copper, if you are using copper wire instead of nichrome wire, there also ammeter reading changes. Okay, for different materials, different amount of current flowing in the circuit. So from this observation, this is the conclusion. The change in the current flow in the circuit is due to the factor that resistance of the conductor depends on its length, its area of cross section, and nature of its material. Nature of its material. These are the three important factors. Okay, length, area of cross section, and nature of the material. It depends upon temperature also, but we are conducting this experiment in a particular temperature. So temperature is not varying. So length, area, and nature of the material. Accordingly, we can write resistance increases with length. That is, when the length increases, resistance increases. Hence, current decreases. Similarly, resistance decreases with area. That is, area increases, resistance decreases, so current increases. Similarly, resistance varies with the type of material. Mathematically, we can write it as resistance is directly proportional to length. R is proportional to L. Then resistance is inversely proportional to area, that is R is proportional to 1 by A. Inverse relation we write like this, reciprocal, 1 by A. And combining these two relations, we get R is proportional to L by A. R is proportional to L by A. And removing that proportionality sign and writing the equality sign, we can write it as R is equal to a constant. Okay, this is a constant. Proportionality constant into L by A. So this constant is called rho. Rho. Rho into L by A. What is rho? It is like R, it is read as RHO. Rho. Okay. Where rho is the constant of proportionality called electrical resistivity of the material. Another one more term we are going to define. Just similar to resistance. Another term is resistivity. Okay. Resistivity of a material. So this is another important relation for resistance. One relation we have seen from Ohm's law is R is equal to V by I. This is another relation, R is equal to rho into L by A. This is how resistance of a conductor depends on length, area, and nature of the material. This term rho is related to nature of the material, resistivity. Let's see what is resistivity. Another name for resistivity is specific resistance. It is denoted by the letter, Greek letter rho. Okay, rho. Definition of resistivity is like this. It is defined as the resistance of a conductor of unit length and unit cross section. It is the characteristic property of the material. So for any material, if you are taking like nichrome, copper, aluminium, any material if you are taking of unit length and unit cross section, it will have a particular value of resistance that will not change with its length or any other factor. Resistivity is a constant. Resistivity does not change with the length or area. It is same for a particular material. If it is a nichrome, its resistivity is particular value. If it is a aluminium, its resistivity is particular value. Like that. So it is a characteristic property of the material. Okay. It is constant always. As resistivity or specific resistance. It is specific for a particular material. Specific. It does not change. That is resistivity. Whereas resistance means it will change with length and area, all that. But resistivity is same for a particular material. For nichrome, one resistivity value will be there. It will be same any time. If you are increasing the nichrome wire length or changing the area of nichrome wire, but still resistivity will not change. Okay, that is the difference between resistivity and resistance. You should understand it properly. Resistivity is a constant. It is specific for any particular material. Okay, this is the resistance offered by a particular material of unit length and unit cross section. It is it is denoted by rho, that we know rho, and its unit is ohm meter. Okay, ohm meter is the unit for resistivity. Some important points about resistivity is resistivity does not change with the change in its length or area of cross section, but changes with the temperature. Okay, with the temperature resistivity changes, but there is no change in resistivity with the length or area. Range of resistivity of metal and alloys is 10 raised to minus 2, 10 raised to minus 6 ohm. Okay, range of resistivity is in this range for metals. For insulators, insulators means which do not carry current, electric current, resistivity range is 10 raised to 12 to 10 raised to 17 ohm meter. What do you understand from these two values? For metals offers less resistivity, 10 raised to minus 8 it is, very small value. So metals and alloys resistivity value is very less, whereas in insulator resistivity is very high, 10 raised to 12 to 10 raised to 17 means very high value. That is why insulators do not carry, it do not allow electric current to flow through it, because it offers a very high resistivity. Whereas in metals and alloys, small resistivity, so it allows electric current to flow through it. And comparing with alloy and metal, resistivity of alloy is higher than that of metals. Okay, comparing alloy and metal, resistivity is more for alloys. That means conductors or metals conduct more electric current. Then only alloys will come. Then finally insulators. Insulate do not conduct. Another important point about alloy is alloys do not burn or oxidize. Oxidize readily at high temperature. As temperature increases also, alloys do not burn. So they are commonly used in electrical heating devices like heaters, electric heaters, you might add iron box, all that. Alloys are used as the heating element because of this property. Another important property of this material is copper and aluminium are used for electric transmission lines as they have low resistivity compared to metals. Comparing in metals, aluminium and copper has less resistivity. So they are used in electrical transmission lines, which means electric current flowing through a transmission lines. So these transmission lines uses copper and aluminium. So these can be used as a reasonable questions. Why alloys are used in electrical heating devices? This is the reason. Why copper and aluminium are used in electrical transmission lines? This is the answer. So there is a table in your course book, table 12.2, electrical resistivity of some substances at 20 degrees, a particular temperature, okay. No need to by heart these values, but you should have an idea how the resistivity of different materials changes. So for conductors, these are the ranges, okay. Silver, copper, aluminium, tungsten, nickel, iron, chromium, mercury, manganese, like that it is given. Alloys, constant and manganese, nichrome. Insulators, glass, rubber, ebonite, diamond, paper, like that different values are given. You can note down the resistivity increases here in this order downwards. Resistivity increases in this order. Downward it increases. So resistivity is small here. 10 raised to minus 8 means to small values. But 10 raised to 12 means very large value. So resistivity decreases from conductors to aluminium. Conductors to insulators. That is why electric current flows in conductors, whereas it do not flows in insulators. So these are the important factors about resistivity. So note down here, in among the conductors which is having high resistivity, silver, then copper, then aluminium, then tungsten, nickel, iron, like that goes. Alloys, comparing constant and manganese and nichrome, then insulators. So like that the values of resistivity changes. So resistivity means it is a property. So if you are using a silver wire, it has this resistivity. When you increase the length or area whatever of silver wire, resistivity does not changes, but resistance changes with the length and area. Okay, so this is the difference between resistivity and resistance. You should understand it properly. Okay, that's all about this presentation. If you have any doubts, please ask. Thank you.